Hey, what's up, all you sweaties? It's Heroes episode 28. Hey, I'm Jon Schnepp, and back from New York Comic Con. We've got a lot of incredible stuff to cover with the cinematic and television world of superheroes, supervillains. Let's get right into it. Let me introduce our guest this week. We've got Vito over here, Lapicolla. Thanks for being here, Comics
Thank
on
you.
Comics.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's good to be back.
Right on, right next to him, Umberto Gonzalez from Heroic Hollywood. Thanks again.
Thanks for having me. What's popping, cool kids?
Yeah,
glad to be back.
We got a lot of stuff to cover. Let's get right
Indeed.
Into it. Before we do, I wanted to definitely mention Collider.com has got a contest going on where you guys can win a very rare piece of never-before-sold art by Tyler Stout that he did for the Avengers Age of Ultron. This was never sold. It's a giveaway. There's a grand prize winner and two runners-ups. So if you just go, you can get by subscribing to Collider and go to Collider.com to enter, and you can win one of these insane Tyler Stout posters. That guy's art is incredible. It's like that's one of those amazing things. You're like, I want that, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm signing up when I get home.
Oh, yeah. Me too, man.
Marvel so Superman. Get on that, subscribe, and go to Collider.com and get that poster. All right, our first order of business today, Marvel dropped that they're going to be doing Antman and the Wasp. It's being released. It's a movie. It's happening. Marvel announced a sequel to the surprisingly entertaining Ant-Man film. It's coming out July 5th, 2018. Black Panther moves up to February 16th, 2018, while Captain Marvel moves forward to March 8th, 2019. Let's start off with Vito. What do you think about this Marvel news involving Ant-Man and the Wasp?
I got a lot of crap for this last time I was on because I wasn't a big fan of the Ant-Man movie. However, it's almost as if Kevin Feige was listening to our episode because, like, I wanted to see the Wasp in action. We're going to see the Wasp. Yeah. I'm happy that that's going to be happening. I'm wondering if Ike Perlmutter wasn't allowing the Wasp to be in the lead because he wanted to keep women out of the focus of Marvel, and now that Feige kind of took over and said, screw you, I'm going to do what I want to do, I think they were like, let's pop the Wasp in there and do the movie we always wanted to make. So I'm actually happy, and I hope that they give Paul Rudd funnier stuff to do.
Umberto, how about you?
It's all good. As long as they don't bring back Michael Peña, we'll be fine.
Right.
And I won't start. But the Wasp is an integral part of the Avengers, and
totally.
I have a feeling we see her. We'll see her pop off in the Avengers. So I'm for it, man. It's good.
Yeah, you know, it was interesting. We brought this up on Movie Talk earlier today. What if, like, the Ant-Man and the Wasp is actually the original Michael Douglas, Hank Pym Ant-Man and the Wasp adventure?
That'd be amazing.
I mean, you could have both versions of that. They get to start the movie in the 60s and do some covert operations, or that can actually be a flashback sequence in the movie. It's still Ant-Man and the Wasp, but, like, both of them. So
an earlier draft of the Ant-Man screenplay actually featured Hank Pym infiltrating like Cuba in the 60s and stuff. But
nice.
But you only saw that in a still image in the movie. And I hope they do that. You know,
that would be amazing. So I think it's great news. I really thought Ant-Man was really entertaining, really funny.
Right.
And refreshing after especially all the dark stuff with Edgar Wright, who's like an incredible director and writer. And I was really bummed that, you know, all that went down with him and Marvel. So to see that, you know, out of those ashes rose actually a fun, entertaining film. And one that was actually, when it ended, I was like, you know, I really enjoyed this film. I wouldn't mind seeing more of the Ant-Man from this version that they've made. So, you know, especially with the Wasp, you know, who doesn't love Evangeline Lilly? She's fantastic.
Yeah, I think it'd be really cool, too. You said that it'd be cool if they did both eras. If they did something like The Godfather 2, where it took place in the main era, but it would flash back throughout the film to get you more backstory with
sure.
the 60s.
Or definitely
be really cool if
followed
they
through.
Did that.
Yeah, it's like, I need you to get this one thing I tried to get. It was like, you know, follow that thief kind of thing.
Yeah, because you could parallel the stories of both Wasps also and how he lost his wife and everything like that. That would be pretty cool, I think.
Yeah, I also wonder if Doctor Strange will indeed have the Easter egg of the original Wasp, like in some weird, like, you know, string theory, super dimensional weird, I'm curled up in the X dimension or something,
yeah,
you know?
That's actually a good call, maybe. I'm wondering if they're going to, what's the name of that field that he couldn't, he had to be careful?
It was the quantum, wasn't it the quantum field? I forgot.
Yeah, don't touch like, that thing
or
you'll
erase.
Go micro.
Yeah, right.
If they find
he's going
there.
Micro. I don't know. Yeah. Well, all right. Well, Ant-Man and the Wasp's happening. Over in the DC universe, we've got Justice League Dark. It's back. It's on. Justice League Dark or Dark Universe, whatever they're going to call it, it's back on the table. With Constantine leading a search for some kind of dangerous mystical books that are stolen. Mm-hmm. He goes out. He's got to get Swamp Thing, Deadman, Zatanna, the Demon. We don't know who else is going to be at Black Orchid. We don't know who's going to be on the team. All I know is, like, I'm really excited that this didn't go dead. I'm glad that they're actually making this film. I love all those characters, the Demon, Swamp Thing. I've been waiting for them to make those films even individually. This is a great way to introduce all of the fans who love DC Comics, like Superman, Batman, to introduce them to this other universe of supernatural characters. What about you, Umberto?
No, absolutely. From what I'm hearing, and this is unconfirmed, DC's going the team routes. Like, Justice League will be their all-stars, their teams. Suicide Squad would be the villain team. Justice League Dark is their misfit team. And then maybe Cyborg bunched up with the Teen Titans could be the teen teams. And they're even thinking about, like, an all-female cast. But Justice League Dark, absolutely, a team of misfits. I love Swamp Thing in the 80s, so yeah. I wouldn't mind seeing him back, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm excited to see Swamp Thing finally kind of get his due in movies. Mm-hmm. I thought the ones from the 80s were okay. You know, they were obviously very cheesy, but to actually kind of get that horror element, especially if they keep the influence that Guillermo del Toro had on there, I think it'd be amazing. I'm hoping they get somebody really cool to play Constantine. It'd be neat, actually, if they got Matt Reeves to come back. Mm. Or was it Reeves? Or Matt Ryan. It'd be kind of cool. I liked him as Constantine. The show was flawed, but he'd be pretty amazing, you know, and they could kind of connect the worlds at that point, too, which I think they may be working on. I think they're working on a crisis eventually.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's hard to tell. I know that Constantine's showing up in the TV universes. I think they're trying to keep him separated, or at least whatever this Constantine's going to be on Earth 1, Earth 2, however they decide to, like, throw their eggs. Like, the movie universes is Earth 1,
right,
and all the people on TV. I thought we were Earth 1. No, you're actually Earth 2.
They've got Lex Luthor thing where he's Alexander Luthor from, what is it, Earth 3? So, mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of weird stuff going on. I think they're not telling us, which means that they might have a plan. You know, everybody's like, they don't know what they're doing, but maybe they do, and they're waiting to kind of, like, spring it on us, you know, full-fledged.
Well, this is a smart play, because this way you get to introduce everyone to all these, you know, fringe characters that, hey, the Demon might be a hit, Swamp Thing might not be a hit, Constantine might be a hit, Deadman might be a failure. So it's like, you don't know, but, like, or all of a sudden everyone's like, we love Deadman, then he gets his own film. So this is kind of a cool way to, like, have that one character going, I gotta assemble the team and go to each of these places. Zatanna, what's her story? All these different characters. So I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, it's gonna be amazing.
Another big announcement, Kevin Feige, after he announced Ant-Man and the Wasp, he also placed stakes down for May 1st, July 10th, and November 5th of 2020 with Marvel Mystery Movies, the 3M. I don't know what you want to call them. It's unknown Marvel Mystery Movies. What will they be? My money's definitely on Guardians of the Galaxy Part 3. That's going to be one of them for sure. And then could it be Moon Knight, Howard the Duck, Nova? You got Warlock. I want Spirits of Vengeance, which would have the Midnight Suns. You got Doctor Strange, Brother Voodoo, Man-Thing, Werewolf by Night, Morbius, Ghost Rider, and Blade. That's too many characters. But I'd say to pick five of them. And, of course, I'd also bet on Avengers Secret Wars. You know? So what do you guys think? Vito. Movies.
I would really love to see a Squirrel Girl movie, which we'll never see, but I would love to see her pop up on, like, the Netflix shows or whatever. But I would like to play a game of what if right now, because I look like the Watcher, so we may as well play what if. What if...
Yes, Uatu. Those,
I am the Watcher. What if they take the three movies and we actually get Fantastic Four and the X-Men back in the what if I mean they're ending the X-Men movies and the Wolverine movies. What if Feige has worked something out with Fox and has there's a lot of that weird stuff going on with the Inhumans right now. What if he actually has a lock on those and he's going to blow our minds by announcing that? That's my what if. It's probably going to be Midnight Suns.
That would be
Suns.
A pretty big mind blow. But, I mean, I know. Also considering all these other characters that they have where they don't have to split the rights.
Right.
Their biggest one was like, yo, we got Spider-Man back. That's a gigantic victory.
Yes.
With the Fantastic Four doing no box office at all over the last few. I mean, hey, the first two films were like semi-hits, but they were just critically panned. This last one was both critically and box office panned. So it's like, that needs a big retooling.
Right.
So whether or not Marvel wants to, hey, we're going to take the first family back, integrate them in with all our other characters, or just, like, let it ride for a while, it's, you know... X-Men, they're not getting that back. Fox is holding on to that forever. Right. That's a gigantic franchise. It's hundreds of characters that they haven't even begun to exploit yet. So, all right, what do you think, Umberto?
I'm guessing right now, I think either a sequel, one or two originals, or two sequels and an original. But it's interesting you bring up Moon Knight, because that's not actually being developed for film.
Right.
The heroic hot rumor is that Moon Knight is actually being developed for Netflix, since he is their version of Bruce Wayne. So I like the way they're backdoor piloting Punisher, making an appearance in like Daredevil season two. Sure. If it works out, boom. Same thing with Moon Knight. Again, he's their version of Bruce Wayne. It's fitted. It's one of the staples that they're developing for their Netflix strategy. And I'd rather see the Netflix version of Moon Knight than the cinematic one.
Yeah, I gotta say, I mean, you know, with Daredevil, with Jessica Jones, with Luke Cage, Iron Fist, then obviously the Defenders. Mm-hmm. This is all. I mean, I didn't think in a million years. I remember mentioning, like, I think it was a year and a half ago on Heroes, mm-hmm. or it was Movie Talk. I was like, when Daredevil came up and Carnahan had made that like 70s pitch reel or whatever, yeah, I was like, right. I don't know why they're messing around with Daredevil in movies. He should be on television. It's a procedural. It's built to happen that way.
Yep.
I was so happy, like, whatever. Some people heard me say that. No, I'm just saying, it's like, whatever was in development, it worked, that it became a television series with all these other series. And that works so well, told over a series of like 10, you have 10 hours.
Yeah.
So I know Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, these expanded movies where mm-hmm. you get to just soak in this universe for like, you know, however you want to binge watch them. Either you get all of them in one day or 2 days or 3 days. Like myself, I still have like 3 episodes left of Daredevil. I know, it's crazy. I know. He's still in the black outfit.
So
he's not in that weird red outfit yet, guys. I don't even know what you're talking about.
So
I'm
good.
I'm savoring it. So all I can say is like, and now seeing the trailer, well, we'll get to Daredevil in a little bit. But anyway, so you think, so you're saying Moon Knight is now being developed for Netflix. Robert Meyer Burnett, you heard it first right here. Moon Knight on Netflix. It's a rumor right now, but yeah. I like that rumor and I want it to be real.
I've heard that too, though.
Moon Knight is a great character. He was one of my favorite characters as a kid when he was first introduced. Why? Because he was very much like Batman, but he had these differences. So it's like, mm-hmm. I think he's like a great combination of almost like Moon Knight and Dr. Fate, but not as spooky mystical style.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. How about you, Vito? What do you think? I mean, I know you're like saying what if with Fantastic Four, but like, who do you think? Like,
you know, I've been racking my brain and I can't really think of who they would bring to the forefront, because, you know, obviously with the Netflix shows and stuff like that, they're going for the lower tier characters and stuff like that and getting them out there and then, you know, hopefully gradually introducing them into the features.
Right.
I would have to say I would love to see a Nova movie.
Yeah.
Nova's badass, dude. And Warlock would be amazing. I think he's going to tie in a lot to Guardians of the Galaxy, so I think they might, you know, pop up. But, I mean, again, who is clamoring for that? I don't know anybody who wants to see. I'd like to see a Micronauts movie, actually, now that they've gotten the micro dimension. Like,
sure.
If they could somehow.
But Marvel doesn't own them. They don't own ROM.
Oh, yeah, they went back to IDW, didn't they?
Micronauts is actually being developed right now as an animated series. So hold your breath. Watch out. Micronauts, I know for a fact, is like, that's where
J.J. Abrams was going to do it as a feature until he got Star Trek, actually.
It would have been fantastic. I still would love to see a Micronauts feature film adaptation, as well as a ROM feature film adaptation. I know there's like ROM is this weird toy that's had a comic book run. Check it out. It'll be an amazing movie. You're wrong. So it's like,
Space Knights are still integral to the Marvel Universe. Okay. They just can't use ROM, which is funny. But
so, I mean, I think for sure you're going to see another Avengers film. For sure you're going to see a Guardians of the Galaxy film. And then one other, like, you know, an individual spinoff film. Whether it's Warlock, whether they chance it and do Howard the Duck.
Mm-hmm. That'd be awesome.
I mean, they keep joking, we're not doing Howard the Duck. I bet you they're going to do Howard the Duck.
So we could all mutually agree that we're getting a sequel and maybe an original or two.
Yes, for sure.
Okay.
All right, let's go over to the Vin Diesel Network and talk about what is going on with Vin Diesel and these weird rumors that he himself is making happen online. He's basically all but confirming that he is the Silent One. He is the one who does not speak. He is Black Bolt.
Black Bolt.
And not only is he Black Bolt, he is in the movie that everyone keeps saying is canceled, which is not canceled. It's not canceled. The Inhumans is happening in 2019. And, you know, hey, look, we're not making the movie, but we're all pretty confident that they're not canceling that film because Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has a few Inhumans on there.
No.
It's really easy. They're setting the tone, the Terrigen Mist, Kree. They're giving you some backstory. none of that matters when the Inhuman movie comes out, because basically when they announce the Inhumans and who's playing Black Bolt, Vin Diesel, who's playing Medusa, who's playing Triton or Karnak or Gorgon, all these characters, everyone's going to freak out. It's going to be super awesome. They'll do the origin over. You'll be find out what the Terrigen Mists are. Some of the characters that were introduced in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. will have something to do with the movie, I'm sure. But it all play into... I think it'll work out great. There's no way they're canceling it. And Vin Diesel is perfect as Black Bolt. His stature, the way he holds himself, the way he can say a million things with his face, that's what you need when you have someone who can't talk. And when they open their mouth, cities explode. So it's like the only way he's going to scream out in pain is like, who? What is gonna make him yell? What do you think, guys?
Oh, I don't think at all. I got to the bottom of this yesterday, all those bleeding cool rumors about this being canceled, that being canceled. Don't believe any of it. Inhumans is fine. Might it get postponed like a two? Sure, maybe. But interesting, there's this superstar on Instagram named Boss Logic. He did, I think, comic book commissioned him to draw Vin Diesel as Black Bolt. And there's a couple of pictures on Instagram, and you can find it at Comic where you see actually Vin Diesel dressed as Black Bolt, and it looks very hot. I think it's a hot idea. He's still involved in the mix, so don't believe the cancellations thing. I'm looking forward to it. You know, I like what Marvel's doing with their space strategy, as they did with Guardians of the Galaxy. It's pretty hot, and Inhumans would be a step in that direction too. So I'm excited to see it.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Vin Diesel's. I think he's an authentic geek. He plays D&D. You know, he's
a dungeon master.
Yeah, he's got a movie coming out based on his own character and stuff like that. I think he's a true geek. He did pose a couple of years ago when he was doing Guardians of the Galaxy in front of a picture of Black Bolt. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm playing somebody at Marvel. Mm-hmm. And it caused a big furor online. And nobody thought it was, Groot. But I think that he knows what he's doing. And I think he'd be killer as Black Bolt. I mean,
absolutely.
Perfect. You know what I mean? And he's got 46 million Twitter followers or whatever, or Facebook followers. So I mean, so now, who's not going to go see that movie?
If half of his fans go see the movie, it's like, oh, the movie just broke $1 billion.
Right.
Because Vin Diesel said, could you please go see my movie? You know?
Yeah. And he's so likable, too. You know what I mean? Like, he plays the tough guy, but he's, like, the coolest dude, you know? And, like, you want to, like, go see... I don't know. It's weird. You want to go see his movies just to support him because he's so cool. But I love the Inhumans, so I'm excited. I mean,
I'm also excited to see who are they going to cast as Maximus, his brother, his evil brother.
Right.
So that's... I mean, it's a lot of really cool stuff going on there. All right, let's go on to something that dropped last week, but I wanted to talk about it. Watchmen moving over to HBO. Now, Zack Snyder has been in talks with HBO to bring the acclaimed graphic novel The Watchmen to the cable channel. Snyder's already made a 2009 feature film adaptation. So we're going to talk about, is this a reboot? Or are they adapting the recent Before Watchmen series that DC Comics just did? Most notably, Darwin Cook's The Minutemen series. Now, that itself, The Minutemen, could be just its own series on HBO. Will Snyder reach out to the same cast? Will he expand his original movie to adapt even more of the comic book? So, I mean, there's all these different things that he can actually do, because when they shot the film 2008, 2009, they can go back and actually fill in some of the scenes, like the artist colony, all these different things. They could change it and take his, you know, 3.5 hour movie and turn it into 10 hours if they wanted to, or they could adapt the Before the Watchmen. What do you think?
Well, I'm really on the fence about this because I'm a massive Watchmen fan. It's almost like a holy book for me in terms of like my favorite, you know, comics. So I wasn't a big fan of the prequels. I like the Ozymandias stuff. The Minutemen stuff was good, but some of it was like need to do it. The comedian one was okay. I mean, it was okay. You know what I mean? I didn't think any of it was crap. I just didn't think it added. If you're going to do a prequel, I think a prequel should always add to the mythos. It didn't really add anything other than the Ozymandias book, which had some really interesting, you know, reasons why you saw why he wanted to go kill the comedian and things like that. I would almost like to see them do a From Dusk Till Dawn thing where they expand the book. And but it'd be really cool, too, to see a season where one season about the Minutemen, one of them is the Watchmen movie and stuff like that. You could do 3 or 4 seasons and really stretch that out. And, I mean, who's to say they aren't going to get... I mean, if they got people like Terry Gilliam or Paul Greengrass, people who had been up for the job of directing the movie, it'd be kind of cool to get those people to come in and let them do seasons or episodes or... You know, I mean, I don't know. The Watchmen universe is very fertile and amazing, so I'm going to... hope on the side of coolness for this one. I'd like to see it. I love Watchmen, so
I kind of cheated though back in the day. Remember when right before the movie came out, the motion comic came out?
Sure.
Yeah. I saw that whole motion comic and watching that before the movie, like, this would make a pretty good TV series and stuff. So anything at this point is possible because all they did was just have a meeting. Even HBO confirmed nothing serious. They just were just meeting and talk because they get pitched on shows all the time. But it could go anyway. It could be before Watchmen. It could be Minutemen. It could be maybe a retelling of the Watchmen book done serialized style, like in the motion comic book. It could be a completely original material. I hope they get Alan Moore to come aboard. That'd be amazing. But yeah,
that'll
it could
never
be.
Happen.
I know that never happened.
He's already.
What could wish though? You
putting
know?
His voodoo. I curse the entire Watchmen. Right. I've completely
disowned it.
Yeah. No, he will not. I mean,
I
that
know,
guy.
Right? It's a no. pipe dream, but still,
he's the most angry man alive. You know what I mean?
I
he's not going to come on board.
Too. Yeah, it's a shame. But
well,
yeah.
Check out Providence while you're at it. That's his new weird Cthulhu based.
Is it good?
Cthulhu
based.
Yeah, it's super weird. So, I mean, all his stuff recently has been like, you know, Lovecraftian.
He's obsessed with like the weird tentacular.
Yeah.
I said tentacular.
Tentacular. I've got a tentacular shirt on.
It's tentacular.
Goon, what's up? All right, let's move on. Here we go into minor mutations. So number one, we've got the Hulk is going to be featured in Thor Ragnarok. It's going to be directed by Taika Waititi from Flight of the Conchords. Number two, we've got Bryan Singer talking about X-Men Apocalypse being the last of the six films. When you see this trailer, you're going to know why. Number three, here comes Damage Control. Marvel's ABC branch is launching a half-hour comedy about the crew that has to clean up after superheroes destroy a city. Number four, we got Jessica Jones is a hit in the special New York Comic Con preview of episode one. Everybody loved it. Then, of course, we got Hugh Jackman leaving everything on the table for his last Wolverine. That's what he said. He's like, I want the script to have everything. I do not want to leave anything out because this is the last one for me. Number five, we've got, number six, we've got Batman, the animated version of The Killing Joke, could possibly be rated R. Of course, we've got Mark Hamill and Kevin Conroy doing the voices. Nice. That's incredible. So, most importantly, that Mark Hamill and Kerry Conroy are doing the voices. So let's hit up, and then the very last one is, of course, Daredevil Season 2, the teaser, dropped just yesterday. Let's talk about all this stuff. What pops off to you, Vito?
I'm excited for Daredevil Season 2. I thought the first season was as perfect as you could get for a superhero show, and the fact that we're going to get to finally see a proper Punisher and a proper Elektra is, I mean, it's like my childhood fantasies like come true. I wanted to do this so bad as a kid. I would visualize this as a TV show. Mm-hmm. So to see it happening for me is like a geek dream come true. Mm-hmm. I just hope we can see Stiltman. I'm kidding. Stiltman's so silly. But I mean, I bet they can make it work. They have such great writers mm-hmm. and actors that even a Stiltman storyline would be amazing within the context of that. So I'm excited for it.
I would love to see Stiltman as like a cameo, like some carny or something. Like, I'm trying to rob a bank. He just gets taken out.
That'd be
like,
amazing.
Like 15 seconds. What do you think?
I am stoked for that rumor that broke yesterday that set the internet on fire. Hulk and Thor Ragnarok. What's good? The Hulk out on some planet, as I've been saying for 2 years, and then he hooks up with Thor in some buddy cop movie. It's a Thor on its own, it's whatever, but Thor with the Hulk, mm-hmm. game changer. I love that scoop. I was excited about it. That's a hot one from the guys from Joe Blow. But like at the end of Avengers, originally, as HitFix reported years ago, mm-hmm. we were supposed to see the Hulk go out into space. They cut away, or you just see him in the Quinjet going out into the distance. It's interesting to see where he's going to end up somewhere. That's going to keep him close to Asgard. So the Quinjet have technology to go into space? I'm not sure.
I don't know, but maybe.
But the Hulk on, and then Marvel dropped some GIF of Hulk and Thor. It's sort of like a confirmation. But that's fire for me, man. I cannot wait to see those two together.
Yeah, I mean, remember, we've got a couple movies before Thor Ragnarok comes out where you can have a little Easter egg, like what happened to the Hulk? Maybe he's not in Civil War, but maybe he's at the very end, like popping off onto a planet somewhere.
Yeah. Right. Oh my God.
You know what I'm
fire.
Saying? Because all they have to do is drop the knowledge that he's on a planet, uh-huh. cut to Thor Ragnarok. You got like Mangog trying to pull the sword to create, mm-hmm.
right.
Ragnarok. Basically, he's like, I need help. Get that dude. He has to go to Thor's, it's a Hulk's planet. Who knows what's going
to happen? And remember, the Korg was in Thor 2.
Mm.
Right? Yeah. That's a character from Planet Hulk.
Right.
That's a good Easter egg right there. Yep.
Well, you ask about the Quinjet being able to go into space. Right. If they follow the comics, which I'm not sure they're going to do, but they had Sword, uh-huh. Shield, Sword,
right.
Wand.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Sword had ships that were capable of going into space. So if they kind of crossed it over, why wouldn't they be able to do it? You know what I mean? Like, I think it's very... Because I wondered that at the end of the movie, too. I was like, how is this, Earth-based ship going to get them to this planet? Mm-hmm. But who gives a crap? It's a superhero movie. Who cares? As long as he gets there
right.
and we get to see... Son of Hulk and things like that. Who cares? It'd be amazing.
So one of the Infinity Stones just transports the Hulk.
Right.
Who knows what?
I mean, you never know. Portal opens up. He's flying along, and it's a movie. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have to have great logic when it comes to superhero
the
stuff.
The point
which
is
awesome.
The Hulk is on some planet out somewhere chilling,
and he's gonna
by
fight.
Himself.
You know, they'll fight first, which would be great. You know,
yeah, that'd be pretty awesome. Yes.
All right, so damage control. I know, Vito, you were excited about that. When I first read about it, I was like, do we really need a Marvel comedy about a cleanup crew? Like, no, they destroyed a building again and shuffle.
It's going to be Michael Pena. It's going to be Michael Pena and his and the Ant-Man crew. I'm just kidding.
You're giving Umberto seizures over here.
But no, I think that, again, we talked about this on the last show we did with She-Hulk and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Like, there's a place for that kind of stuff in the Marvel Universe. You can have your dark corners.
Right.
And you can have your really goofy corners. And I think that damage control, I mean, Dwayne McDuffie, God, what a great writer, passed away a couple years ago. Like, it's amazing to see that his work is going to, be on screen. There's so many tie-ins. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the comics, Damage Control was owned by Tony Stark and Wilson Fisk. Mm-hmm. It's very possible they could, continue that thread and the dynamics they could do with that. I'm all for it. I mean, I think it's going to be amazing.
Yeah, maybe it won't be just a goofy comedy. It'll probably be semi-serious, but the people who work at Damage Control are slightly damaged.
Remember the S.H.I.E.L.D. shorts that they were doing in between movies, how they were a little goofy, but they were still kind of reality based.
I missed those.
I'd love to see that. They're pretty cool. Yeah.
Yeah. The one thing that Bryan Singer mentioned is he did say that in the trailer that they're releasing, you're going to see a clip that's basically the end of Apocalypse. It's the end of the movie.
Interesting.
They're going to ruin it by showing you this scene that brings everything together. So it's sort of like he's already saying, in the trailer, they decided to use a clip from the very last scene of the film. So I'm letting you know right now that this is the last film. It ties all the movies together. So I was like, we'll see in the trailer when they drop it. I guess it's going to drop in the next month or two. So, those are things from Minor Mutations. Let's move into a thing I like to call flashback. And this week we are going to talk about the one and only Fantastic Four film from 2005. It had a young Captain America as Human Torch. It had the dude from S.H.I.E.L.D. as the Thing. It had the hottest woman on the planet at the time, Jessica Alba, as Invisible Woman. And you had some dude named Ian Griffold, or I think that's how you say his name.
Yeah, I think Ewan Griffith.
Ewan Griffith as Stretcho, Mr. Fantastic, Stretchy. So let's talk about this Fantastic Four movie. I thought it was horrible. Goofily directed by the barbershop dude, Tim Story. I absolutely hated it. In fact, I hate this version of Fantastic Four more than the new one.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Man. I just did not like its goofy tone. It just didn't know what it wanted to be. And that's why I fear Damage Control when you try to do that mixture of it's funny, yet we're serious.
Yeah.
Fantastic Four, no one's gotten it yet. No one has been able to get that. They were always talking about, it's about family, it's about this. Well, then show that it's about family.
Yeah, they
about
always
family
miss that
is
aspect.
Not goofy this and that. It's got to show that they're united. It's like Ben is Reed's friend. I mean, I thought that they captured that in the new movie better than any of these other films. He's Reed's friend. That's why they stick together. And it's like, show the romance of Sue Storm and Reed Richards. Why are they a couple? Show why they're a couple. Don't just make it happen. It's like, oh, they're a couple. It's like all these things just miss. And then the back and forth of the Human Torch and the Thing, it was just forced. And this, that back and forth, it's like, that's not how it should be. It should be a little more serious, like ribbing each other in a more serious way. And then it becomes funnier if they're irritated with each other, not corny jokes.
Right.
I don't know. What do you think?
I have to admit, I've never seen the first two Fantastic Four movies. I've seen the Corman one. And I did on your request.
You saw the Corman one instead of these two?
I saw the new one as well, which wasn't as horrible as everybody makes it, but it wasn't great either. I knew that the Fantastic Four, the 2005 one, was going to be in trouble when the people who did the Hellboy suit put in a bid to do the Thing suit, and they were like, no, we're going to go with this guy. And then you see this Thing suit, and you're like, dude, Hellboy, the Hellboy people would have made it so much cooler. I saw that, and I knew I wasn't going to like the movie. I didn't like the casting other than Chiklis and Chris Evans, so I didn't go see it.
Mm-hmm.
I have nothing to contribute otherwise. I mean, it looks like the Fantastic Four. You watch the trailers. It looks way more like the Fantastic Four than the new trailer does, but I still can't bring myself to watch it because I love the Fantastic Four. Mm-hmm. And I want to see a great Fantastic Four movie. So I haven't watched it.
All right.
I got some history with Fantastic Four because I'm actually the guy who broke Tim Story's a director 11 years ago. So right I've been doing this for a long time.
Why didn't you stop him?
I'm just a messenger on this one. And I remember it's a bit of a heroic history. Peyton Reed at the time was one of the...
Yes, he was. And he was going to do a 1960s style adaptation, which I think... Then after discovering what a sweaty Peyton Reed is and how much he loves comic books and how much he added so much other comic book information, Easter eggs, and lore to Ant-Man, how great he would have been to direct the Fantastic Four.
Do you know who he wanted to play Reed Richards?
No.
Tom Hanks.
Wow.
And Tom Hanks was signed on to play him. That would have been amazing.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
I smell a What Happened film, Fantastic Four with Peyton Reed. So I mean, what did you think of...
I thought it was corny. I think it was in the first one or second one where Reed is doing this dance with his arms and stuff. And then her, like, okay, look, Jessica Alba was Latina, and I think she was trying to be white in this movie, like getting with the blue contacts and the blonde hair.
Very weird.
It did not, it looked very weird. It was very awkward and stuff. But the movie was whack.
What, you guys didn't like Dr. Doom having electrical powers?
Nah.
Come on. Why did they, why can't they get this guy right?
You know what?
What's so hard about it?
It's simple. He was friends with Reed Richards in college. Reed tried to say, look, man, your calculations, I went over it because we're pals. We're working together. I saw your calculations were off. You're just trying to ruin my experiment. He doesn't listen to Reed. The experiment goes bad. Some stuff happens. He explodes. He gets his face burnt. He blames Reed. You tampered with it because you didn't want... He was trying to like create a portal to talk to his dead mom. That's what that weird device that he was building. Anyway, he goes off. He's actually the, you know... takes over Latveria. I don't know how you want to do it in the comics. There's all these different ways. He's the son of Latverian king, this and that. He should be from Latveria. It makes it really simple.
That was in the new movie, though. Yeah. There was a little moment where they were looking over something. It said, you know, city of origin or whatever. Right. It was like Latveria. And I was like,
no, I mean, it's sad because the new Fantastic Four film had some moments in the first.
It really did,
For the first 60 minutes, it was okay.
Yep.
Once they kick into the third act, you could see where the development executives put their nose and when they came into the research.
Where you really saw the producers were like, we'll handle it from here. Yeah. Let's ruin this
and
movie.
It was to be fair, for the first hour and 20 minutes of that movie, nothing happens, though.
But
there are relationships. Like, I liked what they did with Reed and with Ben and stuff like that. I liked how they were setting it all up, but it was all set up to the point where you were like, where's the villain literally doesn't show up for an hour and 15 minutes. They're like, maybe we should bring him into our dimension and figure this out. He shows up and then he's like, I'm going back, kills some people, and then the movie ends. And you're like, why was there no setup for that? You know what I mean? He just shows up and does it.
It's crazy. A lot of that stuff was shot. It was just cut out.
Right.
So, I mean, you know, who knows if there'll ever be a director's cut of that film? Probably not.
What if it's amazing? That's my question. What if it's amazing?
Well, I know what's not amazing. This movie, Fantastic Four, the 2005 version, is like, all right, let's stop talking about it. Let's move on.
Poor Jessica
to Spotlight, which is where we're going to talk about a character or characters who have been comic books but never really adapted into the world of television or movies. And this week we are talking about Deadman. So this is another one of DC's supernatural characters. Deadman tells us the tale of Boston Brand, a circus high-wire trapeze performer who's murdered and then comes back for revenge. The series had haunting cinematic art by the infant terrible Neil Adams. And when looking back at it now, this could make a great movie or episodic kind of procedural mixed with The Fugitive. It had contract killers, secret assassins, Hindu mysticism, ghosts. What else do you want? You know, it's got a dead dude, you know? Yeah. He's like, looks like the Spectre. You know, it's like, what do you think, Umberto? Did you ever read Deadman when you were young?
No, I didn't read Deadman, man. But I'm going to, last time you recommended Minutemen, I felt, Miracle Man.
Right.
I fell in love with it. So I'm going to take your recommendation seriously. And when I go to the shop, I'll probably check out Deadman.
Right on.
I've always loved the mystical stuff that DC does. That was my jam. Like, I read the first Alan Moore Swamp Thing, like, off the press and was like,
right.
You know, and that kind of like made me love the DC.
Was it anatomy lesson?
It was
the one before.
It was the one before that, but yes,
he
to be
tied
fair,
up everybody else's
story.
Yeah,
the tie
up
story wasn't very good, but then like the anatomy lesson was the one that made your like
that
mind
destroyed.
Pop
that's
open.
Like one of the best horror movies that has not been made. It's like a comic book.
Yeah.
It's called The Anatomy Lesson. I think it's Swamp Thing 21.
21.
It is incredible. It'll blow your mind.
It's the very first Alan Moore story ever published in the United States.
Second one.
Number 20. Yeah, you're right. Damn. But anyway, number 21 was the one that blew my mind. And, you know, I love the stuff. Deadman was actually going to be a series, I think, produced by Guillermo del Toro. He's been really pushing, like, the mysticism stuff. I would love to see it as a TV show. You'd have to do a procedural. I know they were also talking about doing the Spectre as a spinoff of Constantine.
Sure.
I think with Justice League Dark coming, that's a perfect opportunity for them to take each of these characters and splinter them off. I mean, who wouldn't want to see a show about a guy? It's the Quantum Leap, essentially, right, with ghosts.
Totally.
And, you know, I mean, it's a great concept. Yeah, he takes people over for a little while. How horrible would it be, though, to die and be stuck in that costume? Like, this freaking, I mean,
I know, but horrible. No one ever sees him. Like, we as the comic readers see right. him in that costume, but then he just right. jumps from body to body.
A leotard for all of eternity. Like, how horrible. Yeah. God.
You're always in your trapeze artist.
Yeah, you're like, it's so uncomfortable.
You know, it's a sad thing to me that they canceled Constantine way too early. Yeah. It was actually, you know, it had a rough start, and then it really started getting great when they canceled it.
Yes.
And I think they were introducing, I think his name is Jim Corrigan, the character who then is basically becomes the Spectre.
Yeah.
They were introducing all these characters that would have made a great and rich television universe of side and supporting characters who could then possibly spin off into their own TV shows.
But like, he is going to be on Arrow. I mean, Matt Ryan is returning this season on Arrow,
and I know. I think
the fourth or fifth season. So that does give you the possibility of having the Spectre and Dr. Fate show up on Arrow and right. spinning off into
That's true.
Other
it's
shows.
Not dead completely.
I'd assume they'd show up on like Legends of Tomorrow and stuff like that. Like there is an, you know, that possibility.
Right.
No. But
Greg Berlanti, if you're watching this show, we want to see the Spectre and
yes,
Deadman on any one of those shows.
Yes,
Sorry.
We do.
Okay. So let's
and
move
the
on.
Question. And the
and
question.
And the question, you yes. know. But I think the question is like he should have his own movie. I don't know why Kevin Smith has not made that movie yet, because he would love to
I'd
make
be all
it.
Over
so
that.
All right, let's move on to Twitter questions. Number one, we've got Anthony Kincart asks, do you think Marvel will introduce Jim Hammond? They did reference him in the first Avengers. Now, Jim Hammond is the original Human Torch from the Invaders.
Yes.
So in the very first Captain America scene when they went to the World's Fair, you saw that Jim Hammond
just
sitting in this glass vial. It was just another one of those Easter eggs where you're like, it's the Human Torch. And like, it was just kind of like a little throwaway. Are they going to go back to that? What do you think?
I don't think so. I just think that was fan service to me. I could be wrong, but it felt like fan service to me, and that's all it is. How about you?
I also think it was fan service, but it would be really amazing if they did a Howling Commandos movie and kind of worked the Invaders. They'd have to rejigger the Invaders because they don't have Namor and stuff like that, but like you could easily pop him in there and get another Cap movie out of it.
Right.
You could have Cap be the cameo.
Well, I know Feige. Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, what if one of these mystery movies is a Howling Commandos movie with Agent Carter?
Well, that's the thing. Feige said, we've got another World War II. We've got another period piece movie that we want to make because Cap, the First Avenger, was such a success.
I would love to see that movie.
Oh. I'd say
and
the Invaders could be it.
Well, here's my question, though. With the Human Torch being kind of like owned by Fox, is the original Human Torch owned by Fox is the question.
That's a good question.
Because Namor, you know, is owned, I think, still by Universal and a couple of other things.
Right.
So I bet they want to do it, but they can't because the rights are tied up. That'd Probably be amazing to see that movie.
Absolutely. That's true.
Yeah.
Next question, we got Mike J. asking, I saw a report that HBO is talking with Zack Snyder. Can a Watchmen reboot work as an HBO series? I think we answered that question. Hopefully
Absolutely.
It does happen. So... Rob Gates, next question. We got Rob Gates. Dear Super Schnepp friends, will Adam Warlock emerge from the cocoon that the Collector had in Guardians Volume 1?
Hmm.
Now, I kind of doubt that. I know they had the Easter egg. They had a bunch of stuff and a bunch of different, there's Beta Ray Bill before he turns into the horse face guy. They had a billion people in these glass vials. I don't think they're going to do that with Adam Warlock. I would think that... You know, my guess would be that Adam Warlock is going to be Star-Lord's dad, or they're going to introduce him in a different way where he could be part of the High Evolutionaries, like, you know, new way of making man or something. I don't know if they're going to just say, you know, that cocoon that was in that scene, that throwaway scene, then he breaks out and there he is. I think they're going to introduce him in a different way. What do you guys think?
I think we're seeing Adam Warlock for sure in the MCU. I just don't know how yet. I mean, again, they haven't cracked the script yet to... The Infinity Wars is just starting to work on it now. So anything at this point is possible. James Gunn is still in the writing stage, I think the third or fourth draft now of Guardians of the Galaxy 2. So that's within the realm of possibility. He could be Star-Lord's dad. I'm not sure yet, but I have a feeling we will see him in the MCU. I don't know if that cocoon is what kept him in there.
Right.
Who knows? But it's pretty good fan service also, I guess.
Right.
Yeah, it's interesting because I remember seeing that when I went to the good of the movie, and apparently on the Guardians of the Galaxy DVD, somebody asked James Gunn if that was Warlock's cocoon. He said, No, but it might be a red herring. He said, quote, yeah, there's a cocoon that's exactly like Adam Warlock's. I wasn't really thinking that much when I put that in. That was my idea to put that in there. They're like, what should we put in? So I went into the Marvel handbook and just picked cool things that looked neat to put into the boxes. It looked like Adam Warlock's cocoon, so now everyone thinks he's out there, but I don't know. So that could just be a red herring because he may be, you know, popping him out as Star-Lord's dad, who knows? Right. But it doesn't look like he intended that to be the cocoon, I believe. But who knows?
All right, well, let's move on to the next one. The Big Podkowski asks, why is DC TV using characters that will be in the movies like the Joker? What the F? Are they competing with the film division? Well, look, I mean, the television division is completely with all the DC comics and the movies. They are completely separate and totally different worlds. Yes. With Marvel, they are tying in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. with Marvel. Agent Carter ties in with Captain America. So those worlds of movies and television are tied together. With DC, they are not. And in fact, I think the way that DC is doing it is great. They're having their cake and they can eat it too by having the Flash open up these different worlds.
Yes.
Now, the way the Flash was used to destroy worlds, like in on Crisis on Infinite Earths, where it was like, look, we've got too many worlds and too many. So there's like a Superman with Super Chimp and Super Crypto. And so we've got a million Superman. Let's make it all. Let's combine it into one world and then make more worlds and then combine them and make more. So every 5 or 6 years, there was a reboot happening. And now we have it every year, which is why so many comics are screwed up right now. They just, you know, they're using it as a marketing device as opposed to a housekeeping device. That, you know, with that, I would say that DC's got a little better grasp on it by keeping things separated, but opening that world where there is an Earth 1 or Earth H, or they can just say, you know, the DC movie universe takes place on this parallel universe. And if we wanted to cross over and have this big team up, that could happen. What do you think?
Basically, you pretty much nailed it. I've been saying it for years. Like, people complaining, why don't we see Grant Gustin's Flash in the movie universe? It's not happening. Because the CW and the movie division are all under the same parent company, which is Time Warner. Right. They're just two separate universes. Like you said, Earth 1 here, and then Earth whatever here for the CW. But you're not going to see any of those characters from these CW shows in the movies. That's a pipe dream, quite frankly. So, but you pretty much explained it best.
Yeah, it breaks my heart. I worked in the TV industry for a little while, and to see the divide between the movie and the television units, I mean, they hate each other a lot of the times because they're completely separate entities. Mm-hmm. And so even though they're supposed to be working together, they kind of like fight each other. But they did set up the Crisis on Infinite Earths in the very first season of The Flash. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think it was, I can't remember, it was the first episode, but when the reverse Flash went into his room and it said Flash disappears during Crisis. Mm-hmm. So there is the possibility that they could set that up eventually. I mean, Jay Garrick is showing up in season 2 of The Flash. Right. Who's to say that you can't pop into another universe and run into the movie people? It's very possible. I think they're giving themselves the out to be able to do that if they need to. But I don't know. I would love to see them cross over, but I don't think it's going to happen.
I personally don't want to see them cross over. Neither that way. I mean, look at it this way. Gotham has nothing to do with Flash or Arrow.
Oh, thank God.
So
thank
Flash God. And Arrow and Legends of Tomorrow are all going to be these three TV shows that are all tied together that are going to have a lot of fun with all these different characters. I think that's like a great little pocket universe of fun for DC Comics fans. I think Gotham is a completely other beast where they're having fun with the idea of having all these characters without Batman.
Yeah.
So to me, it's fundamentally weird.
Yeah, it's flawed.
I've watched a few episodes and I kind of like it. And I like that they're introducing this Joker and they're introducing all these even more villains. And they're proceeding to, they're going to change the origins of Batman and have, like, basically instead of Batman creating these villains are now creating Batman.
Right.
They're the cause of supply and demand. You're like, we've got too many costume freaks, but no one's around.
Right.
I'll put on the bat outfit. You know, it's like, as opposed to, like, you know, you created me when you showed up, the whole Batman, Tim Burton, yin-yang type of a thing, which was created specifically for movies to be able to tell a story within a two-hour context. You're like, I created you, you created me first. It just makes it easier. And ever since that Batman movie, almost every superhero movie has used that yin-yang formula because that's all it is. It's a formula that you can apply to any type of a story. So I think within the context of television, you don't need that formula. Henceforth, you have a lot more freedom because you got 22 hours to tell a story in season 1 as opposed to 2 hours in a movie.
Right.
All right, let's move on. Right. We got Brandon Granzow asks, what is your opinion of Batman Year 2, Fear the Reaper? So this is the first Batman graphic novel I read, but it seems controversial. So basically, it wasn't a graphic novel. It was a series of issues that were in, I believe it was Detective Comics. It was after the Batman Year One, which Frank Miller and David Mazzucchelli did. And that was following Frank Miller's, you know, amazing, you know, comic-changing event, The Dark Knight Returns. So basically, they asked him, hey, tell Batman's origin. Or maybe he came to them and said, I've got a new version of Batman's origin. But they actually ran it in Batman. So it wasn't like a prestige format, a spinoff. I think it was Batman 404. And it was like, it changed everything. The way David Mazzucchelli took Frank Miller's script and just masterfully illustrated that. It was like,
yeah,
the master, like that dude turned from like an early Gene Colan kind of like guy into like a Alex Toth master illustrator. Like every panel in that comic book is beautiful.
Kidding. Yeah.
I mean, let's just say, Mazzucchelli, where are you? I know you're doing your independent stuff. I think it was called like Trapezoid, Zuazaz, whatever that was, like
Asterios Polyp.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. It was fun, but I was like, every time I see his stuff, I have that little like, man, I wish he would return to form of at least doing, he doesn't have to do superhero stuff, but something in that vein.
Well, you remember the run he did with Frank Miller on Daredevil was amazing too. Like the Born Again. Was it Born Again?
Born Again.
God.
Incredible stuff.
It's, you know, I remember liking the Year Two stuff, but I mean, after the Frank Miller and Mazzucchelli thing, you're like, eh. I mean, it had art by Alan Davis, which was amazing.
And guess what? The first issue had... art by Alan Davis, and then guess who slapped in there? Todd McFarlane.
I was about to pull your nerd card because you didn't mention Todd McFarlane. No,
I was holding it, yo. I got that ace is deep, son.
Now, see, I haven't read this since it came out, so it's been a long time, but I remember the Reaper was like a guy with like red, he had a skull, and
like the Phantasm.
Master of the Phantasm is basically where they got
that. So I remember liking it, but it was a big letdown from like the reality of the Frank Miller stuff. Like, you read Batman Year One and then Batman Year Two, and you're like, it was good.
I would even say it wasn't that good because it was like you can't call it Year Two because the bar is set so high from Year One. All these, remember Robin Year One? Everybody was popping off of Year One. I was like, that sucks. That sucks. It's not that they sucked.
Right.
It's just that they threw the name Year One or Year Two on it. Where if it was just simply the tale of like Batman fighting the Grim Reaper and it was like a flashback to when he would use a gun.
Yeah,
and why he stopped using a gun. It was like one of those things where it's a Batman using a gun, that's against everything he believes in. Well, here's a little story about why he doesn't use a gun.
And he did use guns in the original comics.
Right,
the
original like guns, he threw issues. Dudes off buildings, he killed people left and right. He'd be like, at least that saves the criminal justice system, like just murdering people. Right. So, you know, hey, you know, did you ever read Year Two?
When Tom McFarlane was blowing up with Spider-Man like in 90, I went back and looked for those singulars because that's when I was really heavily speculating when I was in high school.
Oh yeah.
So I went specifically to get Year Two just for the McFarlane artwork.
Right.
You know, so I had to find I found issue three, then one and two. I put them all I have them to this day.
Right.
I put it together eventually, but I don't remember much of the story. I just remember the artwork by McFarlane.
Yeah, he had a cool way to draw the cape, and then he brought that with him when he finally busted off and did Spawn.
Yeah.
Like he did Batman's cape, where it's just its own like living weird thing that was floating over buildings and stuff.
This is like messing with my memory now because I remember the comics. I remember what the Grim Reaper looked like and stuff, but I didn't remember that it was Todd McFarlane.
Right, it was his early work. It's like
a dastardly thing.
His thirsty face.
Yeah. It was like even before he rocked the Incredible Hulk, where he's like fighting Wolverine. Yeah. And his
massive
Hulk was
forehead.
Like, super. Like strange wedge-like Hulk, like he's all rubbery looking. He's got a million lines.
That was a
on
great
him.
Hulk, by that the way. That Hulk. That
yeah, it was
that
fun.
Peter David McFarlane stuff was amazing too. So
yeah, I can't actually vouch for Year Two as being on par with Year One, but it's a fun story.
Yeah, and if you're a McFarlane fan, go back.
That's like McFarlane's first work. Yeah. So it's right up there. So let's move on. We got Dean. Will we see Thanos' Chitauri army in the Infinity Wars films? Dear Lord, I certainly hope not, because that's my biggest complaint about all these Avengers films, is they fight some mindless horde of like, the insectoids are here. If we can only reach the silver orb, which is controlling them, there, I've done it. Then they all fall dead.
Right.
Chitauri, insect creatures. Then you got Ultron's robot creatures. And there's like, what's going to be in Infinity War? Some other, you know, it's like, hang on, you know?
But has that been something you've talked about in the past, about how with CGI and stuff like that and with all the political correctness that goes on, you can't have them killing real stormtroopers, right? You got to put robots in there now, you know, and feed the CGI machine. So, like, it's less personal to see Thor killing these alien insects I'll say than it is human beings.
Yes and no. Look at Guardians of the Galaxy and what they did. They had Ronin attacking a planet and all of the Nova Corps sacrificing their lives to create an energy shield, and they died.
Yeah.
Heroically, that's true, they died, but they sacrificed their lives to delay it just long enough to, until the Guardians knew that, hey, if we bond together, we can stop him. One of those type deals.
Right.
But they can do it. They just haven't done it yet. And unfortunately, the Avengers Age of Ultron, because of the, you know, hey, I've already seen this kind of thing, even though there were some amazing fight scenes, and it was some of those scenes in Avengers Age of Ultron are just incredible. I've never seen kind of action scenes brought to life like, oh, my God, this is... this is superhero fighting like I've never seen. It just has no weight to it.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't matter. They're fighting a bunch of robots.
Yeah.
Okay. So, like, I think hopefully in Infinity Wars, there's a lot of villains they haven't used yet. Now, I know Fox owns Doctor Doom and Magneto, but they've got a lot of other characters. Red Skull's still alive. Loki's around. They got Thanos. They've got a lot of characters that when the Avengers Infinity Wars starts, whatever they're gonna be a couple more people lined up where it's not just gonna be a sea of army, you know, fighting another sea of army people where it's boring.
What was the name of the alien race again in Avengers 1?
Chitauri.
Chitauri. They were the Ultimates versions basically of Skrulls.
Yeah, the Skrulls.
So that's what I was thinking. I was thinking of the Skrulls.
And that's the sad thing too, is that you weren't able to have them shape change and things like that, and you can't do like a secret invasion kind of storyline because they're just these faceless, you know, insects. So they kind of like.
But that's what I remember. I don't think they own. No, I remember
they don't own Skrulls. Yeah,
they didn't own the Skrulls, and that was a rumor for like the first Avengers movie, but ended up being the Chitauri.
But they could have done an invasion thing, and they could have done some kind of transformational thing, just not Skrulls. But, how they did the first Avengers, it worked for the first Avengers. Yeah. I still love the first Avengers.
Especially when Hulk is smashing them around buildings.
Yeah, it's good to have those disposable army guys. It's just disposable on the second army movie, guys. You don't need the disposable robot drones or whatever you want to call them. It's just like, you know.
Do you guys want to hear something very interesting about the Chitauri?
Go ahead.
Believe it or not, in conspiracy theory circles, there are people who believe that there are a race called the Chitauri, which are these shape-changing beings which have infiltrated humanity. If you look them up online, there are guys in like Africa that are shamans and stuff who are like, I kill Chitauri all the time. So Mark Miller actually based those characters on something real, you know,
you
quote unquote, which is very interesting. No, I'm not saying they're real. I'm saying
I can't believe Vito believes in the Sasquatch and the Yowies from Australia.
They're in UFOs, so it makes them real.
No, hang on. That's not what I said.
I can't believe it's so weird that you said that.
That's not what I said.
I can't believe that he said that.
Just look up like Chitauri, like in the conspiracy theory stuff, and it's really fascinating.
And then you'll see a picture of Vito right next to it.
Be like, I'm gonna go hunt them.
It's me with like reptilian eyes.
Right, weird tongue. I told you I exist. He grabs you from the dictionary that you're holding.
Oh, my God.
I do not believe that
stuff.
Right,
we're moving on.
Sasquatch? Do you believe in Sasquatch?
He believes in the Yowie from Australia. All right. Next question. Daniel Fitzpatrick asks.
It's going to be a meme now online. Chitauri eyes.
Should DC incorporate Martian Manhunter into the DCEU? So Martian Manhunter, if you guys don't know who he is, John Johns from Mars, came to Earth. He basically kind of put the Justice League together in the original, like 1960s version. A lot of people hate on him now because he's a big green dude. Kind of awesome. There's a way to fit him in. People are like, he's stupid. It's like, guess what? Superman's an alien. He's humanoid. Right. He's from another planet. Get with it. It's like, maybe you don't make him from Mars. Now, hold on. I know that's like stopping. Everyone was like, well, they have water on Mars. Maybe there was a civilization on Mars. We don't know what, you know, you could still keep him.
There were
Mars.
Chitauri there.
Yeah, there were Chitauri. They all look like Vito. There's like 1,000 Vitos walking around. I'm a Chitauri.
God forbid.
That'd be weird. Like
the only person who'd be happy about that would be my mom.
So what do you think? Martian Manhunter, yes or no?
Justice League? Come on, man. Like, why wouldn't you want to see Martian Manhunter in the comics? They've established that they're extraterrestrials. I mean, the first DC Extended Universe movie is about an extraterrestrial. Of course you could pull that off. You could even pull it off that, I mean, I think Grant Morrison did this where they had acknowledged that Mars was a dead world, but then, you know, the Martians were from an earlier time. You could totally pull that off and make it work within the movies. He's a shapeshifter. I mean, he can pull off some really cool stuff. Why would you not want him in the movies? And he is an integral part of the mythos. You know, I mean, it's, I don't know.
Yeah, Superman can certainly identify with him. He's like, right. I'm with you, man. We're the last of our kind.
Yeah.
I totally believe we're going to see him, because if the rumors are true that we are indeed going to see Darkseid in either the first or the second Justice League film, there's got to be probably a reference to Martian Manhunter in there, if not John Jones personally. I mean, that's one of the questions I get asked the most, if we're going to see Martian Manhunter. I think so. I mean, I'm still trying to crack it, but I have a feeling we will.
Bam, a boom box opens. Poof. Not a boom box, a zoom box. What is it called? The Jack Kirby?
I think they were boom boxes.
I was going to say boom box, and I was like, is it really a boom box? You got the mother box opens. Yeah. Boom tube. That's
boom
what it is.
Boom tube.
Because boom box is something from like hip hop.
Yo, bust out boom a boom box. Yeah. So it's a boom tube opens, right. And John Johns comes flying out, and maybe he's not from Mars. He's from some other planet that Darkseid has just taken over, and he's like, I need your help, or some
you can still call them together. I mean, it's just like anything else. When people see aliens in movies, they go, it's a Martian, and the guy could be like, I'm not a Martian, dude.
I am an illegal alien, but only I'm from the Gore-Tex system. All right, let's move on to the sweaty question of the week. This week, it's from Andy Ward, and he says, Collider Heroes, are the Robin costumes the red, black, yellow, made to pay homage to the original Batman? So that picture that you see right there, that red outfit with the wings and the blonde hair, is actually Bob Kane's original drawing of what that Batman was going to look like. And Bill Finger is the guy who not only wrote all of the Batman comics, but actually was like, hey, you know what would be cool? If he didn't look just like Superman, let's make him wear an all gray and black outfit and have actually a cowl with ears that look like a bat. You know, and also let's, instead of seeing his eyes, let's make those white slits and let's not give me any credit on the thing forever until recently. So I'm a big proponent of people getting credit for what they create.
Absolutely.
Yes, sir.
And I really think that, you know, I was so happy when Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster got their credit for Superman in the 70s. All the Marvel creators who, you know, with Stan Lee, like Steve Ditko and Jack Kirby, I see their names up now on the movies, and it makes me feel good. This kind of very late but very deserved thing that DC Comics finally did for Bill Finger is really important to be able to, even if it's retroactive. I know a lot of things just say Batman created by Bob Kane. Now it's going to say Batman created by Bob Kane and Bill Finger.
That was a very insidious thing that Bob Kane did, by the way, because he basically took that credit.
Right.
There's a story of Steranko confronting him and knocking him out at the DC offices because he stole, you know, the whole concept of Batman. I mean, Bill Finger created the Joker, Robin, Catwoman, Commissioner Gordon,
Gotham City,
the look of Batman. He basically did everything that makes Batman Batman.
Right.
But Bob Kane got all the credit for it. And
well,
so,
I mean, you know what? This happens in television all the time. I've worked on stuff where other people just take credit for what you do.
Right.
I mean, but in comic books, I'm very specific about these rights being allowed. Like, look, just the writers and the artists, they're the co-creators. And that's how it's got to be. I think it should be like that in television, too.
Yes.
You know, and things change. You know, there's always, you know, how things change legally. You got to take it to court.
Yeah.
And that's how it works.
No, I'm very happy that Bill Finger's getting his just due in BVS. But did you guys know today, October 13th, in nerd history, in heroic history, Batman fought the Joker for the very first time?
Wow.
That's pretty great.
Damn. Yeah. Thankfully, he didn't fight him looking like this Superman version. Where am I supposed to be? Oh, right. Gotham doesn't exist. Oh, the Joker doesn't exist. I guess I'll just stand here.
Have you seen that cartoon that somebody did? It's like a one-page thing about,
I love
like, what if Bob Kane was the sole creator of Batman and like nothing happens? He's like, I wish I had some villains to fight. I wish there was a commissioner who could take, you know, I guess I'll just, you know, hang out and kind of do nothing. And then it's his next issue, Bob Kane's other idea. I mean, it's pretty mean.
It's pretty mean.
No, here's the weird thing that you got to think about with this kind of stuff. And I do think it's a very interesting question that they do look, the Robins do look like this character, which is very interesting. Think about the fact that Siegel and Shuster created Superman and made no money. Think about the fact that Bill Finger created all these characters and made no money, and that the people who were making the movies about these characters are becoming millionaires. Those people died penniless and forgotten for the most part.
Right.
That Bill Finger.
So it is
really
very important to you know, that these guys are getting the credit. Hopefully their families are getting some of the money.
Right.
But it does, it kills you. I mean, how would you feel if you created a character and somebody else went off and made billions and you were like, I can't feed my family. And they were like, screw you, dude.
I think about that a lot. Like Death Clock. Whenever I see t-shirts, I'm like, yeah, I created those characters. Too soon. But know what? I empathize with these writers and artists who aren't treated fairly, very much so. So I think it's always good, and it's a victory for true creative artists when this kind of thing happens. With like Bill Finger, I highly, highly respect DC.
Classy move.
Yeah. Very classy. So we're going to end it with that classy move from DC Comics with this issue of number 28. You got Collider Heroes. I'd like to thank my guest, Vito. Where can people find you online?
You can find my show, Comics on Comics, at comicsoncomics.com. You can also find me at Vito Lapicolla on Twitter and at Comics on Comics on Twitter.
Right on. Umberto, where
can
people find
you? You can find me at heroichollywood.com and at El Mayimbe. And tonight at Gold Sports Cafe to root the Mets. Let's go, dale.
Nice. And you can find, hopefully, all of us here on Collider Heroes. We're going to be doing a panel at Kamikaze on Sunday. We're also doing a Collider Movie Talk panel at Kamikaze. So definitely get your tickets to Stanley's Kamikaze. It's happening October 30th, October 31st, and November 1st. And I believe we're doing the Sunday, November 1st slot. We'll be doing a lot of cool stuff. Come on down. Get sweaty with us. You can ask us questions. It'll be a real extra sweaty Collider Heroes panel for sure.
If I may, I would also like to say Comics on Comics has a panel on Saturday from 4 to 5:30 at Kamikaze, so you can come check us out there as well.
Oh, right on. Awesome. Cool. Should be pretty amazing. We won't be conflicting with Vito's Comics on Comics for sure. No. So there'll be a lot of fun
about the Yeti?
He's going to have the small action figures.
I'm never going to live that down.
But that was awesome.
You guys can find me just online on Twitter and Instagram, just at Jon Schnepp and at TDOSLWH. We're going to also be screening the film, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, the documentary film that I made. We're going to be screening that at Kamikaze. It's the first time we're actually screening it for free for fans. Sweet. It's going to be at the Comic-Con convention. So your ticket will allow you to see the film for free. We'll also have a booth there. We'll be selling our Blu-rays and DVDs and posters of the film. Of course, our Blu-rays have like extra 9 hours of incredible interviews with Kevin Smith and all this amazing stuff. You could also, if you want to get the actual DVD or Blu-ray, you can go to our site, www.tdoslwh.com, and order it there or get a digital copy. Once again, this was Collider Heroes. Thanks for coming by and watching the show. We'll be back next week.